The program you're about to see has remained secret almost 40 years. It was made here at the old BBC Television Centre, but not broadcast. The master copy was put under lock and key. Other copies were ordered to be destroyed by the then Director General. But I, as the reporter, didn't follow those instructions. I kept a copy and hoped there would come a day when viewers would see it. Tonight, finally, we've reached that point. And here's the story. In 1979, Panorama and BBC Television News spent months investigating the background to the sensational trial of former Liberal leader Jeremy Thorpe for a special programme. Thorpe, along with three others, was accused of conspiring to murder his former gay lover, Norman Scott, also known as Norman Joseph.
And then he leveled it at me, and then came back, and I suddenly realised he was going to shoot me as well.
We believed a guilty verdict against Thorpe was a certainty. But when the resounding verdicts of not guilty against all the defendants were returned, the programme was halted on legal grounds.
Does it occur to you now that you and the Home Secretary of the day were sitting down and conspiring to pervert the course of justice?
At the time it occurred to me, never mind today.
Today there's a strong and widespread view that the Thorpe verdict was a miscarriage of justice. And we're now broadcasting an edited version of the programme.
It was a whacking great old-fashioned iron and steel safe. It contained nothing but files.
Files on who?
Well, a kind of file that we're talking about now. That were going to create a public scandal, or might create a public scandal.
I've waited 40 years to tell you the real Jeremy Thorpe story. Tonight's the night, at last.
I, being the acting returning officer for the constituency of North Devon, hereby give notice that the total number of votes given for each candidate at this election is as follows. Speller, Anthony Speller.
Conservative.
31,811. Thorpe, John Jeremy Thorpe.
Liberal.
23,338. 23.
Jeremy Thorpe at the moment of his political defeat last May. Tonight, we'll concentrate on how a small but important section of our society reacted to the problems created out of the tension between Thorpe's private morality and his public responsibilities. It's a story that begins in all innocence at school, specifically the playing fields of Eton. Thorpe's education was classically the kind usually bestowed on the young men of Britain who might qualify as leaders in politics, in industry, in the civil service. Men whose hands might one day touch and perhaps hold the levers of power and influence in post-war Britain. At Oxford, Thorpe read law and hurled himself into student life with an energy and drive that were to characterise his future behaviour in politics. Indeed, he was already politically a liberal. He was popular and achieved the remarkable distinction of becoming president of three university societies. This college photograph of a union meeting at the time shows Thorpe together with many young men who were also destined to leave their mark on the coming decade. William Rees-Mogg, to become the editor of the Times. Tory cabinet minister. Norman St. John Stevens. Robin Day was another contemporary whose face was to become all too familiar. Academically, Thorpe's record was not unduly impressive. He left with only a third in law and began his pupillage at the Inner Temple in London. But by 1955, his interest had switched from law to politics, and the Liberal Party picked him for a party political broadcast.
We want to register the largest possible Liberal vote throughout the country so that there's a large, coherent body which no government, whatever its colour, can disregard without doing so at their peril.
But here is our Liberal result from Devon North, which will be with you in a moment, and here it is. The Liberals have won North Devon from the Conservatives.
How long ago is it since the Liberals won a seat at a general election? A fresh new gain. Quite a while.
Thorpe had been elected an MP aged 30. A close friend in these years was Peter Bessell, himself to become a West Country Liberal MP.
We were both essentially showmen. We had our own different techniques, but they were surprisingly similar in practice, based on the fact that the Liberal Party had not got the resources to create the kind of organisation that a Conservative or a Labour candidate can do to win a seat. In other words, we had to sell ourselves. And so Jeremy had the brown hat, which became as famous almost as Harold Wilson's pipe, and I had my gimmicks too, and these made us known. He worked for the people, all sorts of things which I think will always live to his credit.
Were you here then during the by-election? That was in 57, I think it was.
But behind the public face of Thorpe, behind the smiles and all that energy, behind the political style that was to prove so exhilaratingly different, lay the side of his character that was to remain hidden from the electorate to the bitter end. That other side of Thorpe's character first came to the attention of the security services in 1959, the very year he became an MP.
There was an inquiry from London as to whether there was any knowledge in Devon, where Mr. Thorpe was a member of Parliament, as to whether there was any homosexual association known with which he could be connected.
And you were asked to conduct an inquiry into this?
I suppose you could call it that. Yes, it was a very discreet inquiry. It wasn't one that many people knew about. It was done discreetly.
Could I hazard a guess that it was an inquiry done on behalf of the security services? Would that be a reasonable assumption?
Yes, I think so.
What kind of conclusion was reached?
Nothing more than suspicion. And this arose through known associates and so on. Nothing more than suspicion.
There were questions. People were saying, why doesn't Jeremy get engaged? Why isn't Jeremy out with girls? This was the sort of question mark over him. Well, now, in fact, it had no effect at all. He had that brilliant victory in North Devon. But then later, little things happened. There was an incident when he came to my own constituency, before I was the MP, to open a garden party, and brought a journalist with him. And my former wife, Pauline, she was so concerned about this that she told Jeremy to send the young man away because he was paying more attention to the boy than he was to the Liberal workers.
Peter Bessell knew as well as anyone the enormous risks that Thorpe was taking. In the early 60s, homosexuality of any kind was a criminal offence in this country, and it carried severe penalties and equally considerable moral opprobrium. Nevertheless, Thorpe's indiscretion at Bessell's garden party was by no means an isolated event. MI5 were handed the copy of a highly compromising letter Thorpe had written to a homosexual friend in America. Now, it was a characteristic of Thorpe's homosexuality that he did not seek the love that led to long and involved attachments with men. He preferred short, clandestine affairs. But sometime in the summer of 1961, he was to meet the young man for whom this kind of casual and cavalier affair would never be enough.
Good dog, hello.
Today, Norman Scott lives in a rented cottage on the edge of Dartmoor. He has retained a love of horses. In fact, it was through horses that he first met Jeremy Thorpe.
Hello, Slipper.
Scott was then living in Oxfordshire, training at what's known as a working pupil at the stables of a professional show jumper. Thorpe was on a visit to the stables and met Scott at the stable door.
Well, I was very naive and sort of shy person who was really just involved with horses. You know, I can't really say how I felt. He was just a person, you know, above me in every way, socially and in every way. I was just a person working in the stables, so I was a bit in awe of him, I suppose. Good girl.
As a result of profound emotional difficulties, Scott, not long after that first brief meeting, ended up extremely depressed in a clinic near Oxford.
Come on.
Scott left the clinic and headed south to London and Westminster and Jeremy Thorpe, MP.
I walked down to the House of Commons and sent in a green card in St. Stephen's Hall, and Thorpe came out. He was very pleased to see me. And he took me down stairs, down to an interview room, and I told him what had happened. He said I looked absolutely dreadful. Well, I must have looked dreadful. I was very heavily, still under quite a heavy sedation. And I had been given a lot of drugs to take with me. And he said, what I think's the best is you come home with me this evening and we'll talk about things and I'm sure we'll sort something out and you mustn't worry. As we drove almost into Oxford, which is where he lives, now, I want you to say to my mother, he said, don't worry about this, but I just want you to say to my mother that you're part of the camera crew who's going with me to, well, it turned out to be Jamaica. And I said, well, why? Why have I got to do that? I was very troubled about it. And he said, oh, well, it just will make things easier all round. I was very worried about doing it. In fact, it was the first lie, wasn't it? It was very sad. Anyway, we then had a meal, and it'd been quite a journey and things, and so I asked if I could perhaps go to bed. We hadn't really talked about anything, but I imagined that he'd perhaps come and talk to me in the room. So Mrs. Thorpe showed me where I was to sleep, and I went to bed. And as I was going through, he said, oh, would you like a book? And he took a book from his bookcase, which was just inside the door of his room. It was, and he handed it to me. It was this book, Giovanni's Room. And acclimated, did the usual things, and got into bed and began to read it. And then he came in.
And what happened?
Well, he to start with, just sat on the bed and talked to me. I mean, nobody had ever been sort of gentle. It sounds horrendous for people who are sort of don't understand this sort of thing. Well, I didn't understand it either. And but it was just great that somebody was caring, and I just gave up and just cried and cried.
Both men were to meet regularly. Thorpe gave Scott access to his accounts at top London clothes shops. He introduced him to friends in London and the West Country. Thorpe even helped Scott out when he got into trouble with the police. On February the 8th, 1962, Scott was seen by a detective investigating an allegation that he, Scott, had stolen a coat. The detective, noting an apparently close relationship between the two men, wrote a report to his Chelsea police station. This is the report here, and in it he makes a couple of interesting points. First of all, he says that Thorpe told him that he was more or less a guardian to Scott. And later, he says it's patently obvious that Scott is a rather weak personality, completely dominated by Thorpe. Now, this is the first document ever linking Thorpe and Scott, the first official police document. 5 days later, on February the 13th, 1962, Thorpe wrote the now famous, notorious Bunny's letter. And this is clearly an unambiguous and affectionate letter from one man to another. And this is a letter that was to assume great importance throughout the case. It reflected, if you like, the high point of their relationship, a relationship Thorpe was able to cope with, but Scott couldn't. And ironically, it was he who first tried to end the affair.
I just, said I wanted it all to finish. And he said that a great friend of his was the director of public prosecutions, and I couldn't harm him in any way. And that made me very unhappy and very angry, because I felt that our relationship was just based on the fact that he would always be all right. And it didn't matter about me. That's, I think, where it began for me to go very sad and wrong.
Just 6 months after the Bunny's letter, the relationship between both men had clearly begun to cool. This subsequent letter from Thorpe to Scott is cold and formal. By December 1962, with the relationship seemingly at an end, Scott had left London for a while to stay with friends in the West Country. He became increasingly depressed and moody. He drifted back to London and took a hotel room in Victoria. Alone and near despair, he spoke openly of killing Thorpe and then committing suicide. Alarmed at this prospect, a friend called the local police. Robert Huntley was one of the detectives who saw Scott. He was then a detective inspector at Chelsea Police Station. He listened to Scott's strange story and then asked Scott to make a statement. Scott did this and also handed over the Bunny's letter as corroboration of what he was saying. And what he was saying was dynamite for Thorpe. Scott's statement was an explicit account of his sexual relationship with Thorpe. If it was true, then both men were guilty of what was then a serious crime. Not one single man or woman named by Scott in this crucial statement was ever seen by detectives. Not only that, but incredibly the only man who could have settled the allegation one way or the other wasn't seen either.
I do remember we made a decision that there was no need to interview Thorpe because we knew what the answer would be at the conclusion of our inquiry. It would be a denial. And
how did you know he would deny it if you didn't see him?
Well, because of the individual, who he is. I mean, even today, at this present time, he is still strenuously denying there was a homosexual relationship.
How did you know at that time that he would deny it?
Well, that was our assessment. I mean,
how could you assess him if you hadn't seen him?
Well, can you imagine a person in his position coming forward and admitting to a police officer?
But how do you know that he wouldn't admit it?
Well, that was my assessment of the man.
Who took the decision not to interview him?
I took the decision.
Really?
Yes.
And nobody guided you in that at all?
Well, I mean, eventually a report was submitted, and I have no doubt with my senior officer at that particular time that if he wasn't satisfied with my decision, he would have sent the papers back and said, you go and interview him irrespective.
When you carried out your investigation, did you know or were you ever told that a security investigation had been carried out on Jeremy Thorpe by the Chief Constable of Devon?
Not to my knowledge, no. Certainly, if it had been carried out, I would have dearly love to find out what the result of that investigation was.
You were never told?
Never told, and that is news to me today.
It was carried out by Sir Ranulph Bacon.
Well, that's the first I've heard of that.
Now, the conclusion reached by Robert Huntley, who investigated these allegations, was that they couldn't be proven. Nevertheless, the file seems to have been referred upwards and upwards at Scotland Yard. Why do you think that would have been the case?
Oh, because it concerned a member of Parliament.
Now, we know that eventually the file finished up in the safe of the Assistant Commissioner of Crime. What about that safe? What did it look like? A sinister safe, a huge safe, or what?
Well, it was a whacking great old-fashioned iron and steel safe that stood up on a very substantial wooden stand, and it contained nothing but files. We never put money in it or anything like that. And it contained nothing but files, not very many files, but those that it was thought were proper to be held personally by the Assistant Commissioner.
And what kind of files are we talking about? Files on whom?
Well, the kind of file that we're talking about now.
When you
things that were going to create a public scandal or might create a public scandal.
Can you tell me why a file should go into that safe in the first place?
I think in cases where it was important to prevent the file from being open to inspection by all and sundry within the department.
And why should that be important?
Well, there were cases about which the fewer people who knew, the better.
So, at the end of the day, why was Thorpe never prosecuted? Was it just lack of corroboration, as Huntley maintains? I've been told at a very high level that that investigation is today regarded as having been less than vigorous. Huntley, of course, denies that absolutely. The fact is that there were people well above Huntley who were taking decisions too. Well, what was happening in Britain in 1963? In the first 3 months, the nation was being rocked by a series of sex and spy scandals. In 1963, the Profumo scandal began to break. Jack Profumo, then Minister for War, was having an affair with the model Christine Keeler. She, at the same time, was having an affair with a Russian spy. It wasn't Profumo's extramarital affair that provoked the scandal, but his vulnerability to blackmail. Then there was the Vassal affair, a national scandal involving the homosexual Admiralty clerk hopelessly compromised by the KGB in Moscow. Finally, at about the same time, Kim Philby, third man in the notorious Burgess and McLean affair, fled to Moscow too, confirming that Britain's MI6 had been deeply penetrated by the Russians. The last thing Whitehall wanted was yet another homosexual scandal, this time involving a member of Parliament. Now, support for this theory comes from the record of a conversation between Peter Bessell and Sir Frank Soskus, later to become Home Secretary. Bessell had asked him the very same question: why nothing had been done about Thorpe in 1963.
He reminded me of a case which I suppose most people have forgotten today, but John Vassal, if you remember, he was the Admiralty clerk who was prosecuted for passing secrets to the Russians, and his defense in court was that he'd been forced to do so by the KGB because they'd blackmailed him, in effect, because he was a homosexual. And it would not have done at that moment in time to have shown that there was a similar risk in that members of Parliament were open to the same kind of blackmail. And he said that is the kind of consideration that would be taken into account in making a decision not to introduce a prosecution.
In other words, there was a cover-up.
Yes, I think that's right. I think you can't, I don't think it can be described as anything else.
Downing Street is on the screens of the whole world. Under new management is the most famous political house in Europe.
So with Harold Wilson now at Downing Street, Jeremy Thorpe's political star began to rise. The two men were to become good personal friends. By now, the physical relationship between Thorpe and Norman Scott was over, but the sad flotsam of the end of the affair, old letters, were still floating around. Some of them were in a suitcase Scott had lost during a trip abroad.
In the wrong hands, they could be incredibly dangerous. So I wrote to Mrs. Thorpe, asking her to intercede, to ask Jeremy to get my luggage back, and explaining about it all. It wasn't in any way, I didn't wish to cause her any trouble. I thought she knew about our relationship. In fact, I'm sure she did. All mothers know their sons, you know, the depth of their sons' feelings. I was really sorry I had to do it, but there was nobody else I could write to.
Scott's letter to Thorpe's mother, while not a letter of blackmail, was a letter that implied the worst. Thorpe was horrified when he intercepted and read it. It was proof that Scott was turning from nuisance to threat. From this moment, both men, their affair long ended, were to become locked into a new relationship, a struggle in which only one man could win and one must lose. Once again, Thorpe turned to his old friend and troubleshooter,
not
Peter Bessell.
Not for its own sake, but so that we may give to Britain a new hope and a better future. Mr. Chairman.
He told Bessell everything about the affair with Scott, about being homosexual. And in doing so, he placed his political future in Bessel's hands.
What I thought and what I felt was that Jeremy's private life did not affect his public life, that I regarded him as an invaluable member of the Parliamentary Liberal Party, indeed an invaluable member of Parliament, period.
But Bessell was to discover that covering up knowledge of Thorpe's affair with Scott was like holding back a bursting dam. There was always one more leak about to spring. In Barnstable, North Devon, for example, Thorpe learned that there was a file on his relationship with Scott at the local police station. What Thorpe didn't know was that Tim Kegwin, his Conservative opponent in North Devon, had already come across the existence of the file in 1966.
A senior policeman, out of doors, took me on one side, wished me luck and said, and this was quite a shock to me, and he said, I wish you all the best, and if you could only use what we know, we've got a file that fat. And this, quite honestly, rather shook me. I hadn't, you know, known that there was anything that specific about it at all.
That file in North Devon was potential political dynamite, and Thorpe wanted it out of the way. He asked Bessell to handle it. First, Bessell went to see a friend of his, George Thomas, then a junior minister at the Home Office.
I said to George, would you think it a good idea for me to see the Home Secretary? And George said, yes, that's a very good idea. I think he was very glad to be relieved of any responsibility. And he said, I'll set up a meeting for you. So I went by appointment to see Sir Frank Suskis, who was then the Home Secretary, at his room in the House. And again, I went over the facts. And then I moved on to the question of the file and said that it was possible, at least in Jeremy's view, that the Barnstable police might contact the Metropolitan Police and that they would discover the existence of a file resulting from a statement that Norman Scott had made 2 years earlier and letters that Scott had handed over to the police. And Frank Suskis's attitude initially was that he didn't think that was anything to worry about, that it was unlikely the inquiry would be extended.
Does it occur to you now that you and the Home Secretary of the day were sitting down and conspiring to pervert the course of justice?
At the time, it occurred to me, never mind today, that what I was asking was that a privilege should be extended to a member of Parliament that would not be extended to an ordinary citizen. Now, that much said, nothing that Frank Suskis said to me at that meeting or in my subsequent conversations with him implied that he took any step whatsoever to stop any action that the police might have taken or be taking during his tenure of office at the Home Office.
So with Bessell helping to stave off political embarrassment, Thorpe got on with the business of politics, on this occasion international and controversial.
With the backing of a United Nations resolution.
For 2 days, negotiations aboard HMS Tiger held the interest of the whole world.
In May 1966, Jeremy Thorpe went on a special fact-finding mission to Rhodesia. When he returned to London, he was immediately debriefed personally by the Prime Minister at 10 Downing Street. He also saw the Commonwealth Secretary of the day, Arthur Bottomley, who was himself involved in the Rhodesian talks.
I think the value of the trip that he made on the whole was useful.
Was the Commonwealth Office informed by the security services of the existence of a file that indicated he might be a security risk?
Now, I can't answer for the office, but certainly as Secretary of State, I was not informed.
And do you believe that if such a file existed, you should have been informed?
Yes, certainly. I should have been told about that.
Mm-hmm. Are you saying that you're now hearing in this interview for the first time that this file existed?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What, in your opinion, would be the purpose of such a file if its contents are not made known to people like you who were Secretary of State at the time?
I can only assume that the office thought that it wasn't important enough to bring to my attention.
The fact is that by now, Jeremy Thorpe was becoming an increasingly important politician. It had always been Thorpe's ambition to follow in the steps of the party's great leaders of the past, men like Gladstone and Lloyd George. In January 1967, after only 8 years in politics, he made it.
Jeremy Thorpe may not be the next occupant of number 10, but you never know. The Liberals have chosen him to succeed Joe Grimond as their party leader.
The security files that existed on Thorpe made no difference to his political career at that stage. Jeremy Thorpe.
may be the man to attract the voters. In the last election, it took 194,000 votes per Liberal MP.
Nor, obviously, did the farce make any difference a few months later when he was appointed to the Privy Council, one of the most trusted of honours that Her Majesty the Queen, through the Prime Minister, can bestow.
With Thorpe now as leader of the party, Bessell had to deal with the problem of Norman Scott with increasing urgency.
I agreed to put him on a retainer while I tried to find him a job. And I wrote him a letter in which I said that I enclose here with your retainer for the week ending so-and-so and so-and-so. Now, as a matter of record, I'm afraid I'm one of those people who always writes letters, in the sense that I like to keep a record of things that I do. Now, there's scores of them in existence, copies of them. Dear Mr. Scott, or dear Mr. Joseph, as he was this time, enclose here with your retainer.
Did it never occur to you that this might become deeply incriminating evidence in the future?
No, it didn't. It did not.
I mean, in the end, you didn't make a very good job of the cover-up, did you?
Oh, I think I made a botch.
Bessell also tried to help Scott in his new career as a male model, and for a time, his life was more settled. And for Jeremy Thorpe, it was a settled period, too. He met and married Caroline Allpass, a popular secretary in the House of Commons. The best man was David Holmes, a close friend of Thorpe's from his Oxford days. By February 1971, Bessell was offering to set Scott up at a riding school in North Wales. Although Scott moved to the area, the money never arrived. Broke and friendless, he moved in with a widow, Mrs. Gwen Parry-Jones, and told her the whole story about himself and the leader of the Liberal Party.
And she was of the old school that believes that members of Parliament are above suspicion, are incorruptible, and are only there to look after people, not to, well, as it was, destroy, as it seemed to her, destroy somebody, because she could see, had seen, over what she'd seen in evidence of, she'd seen a slow progression of what she considered a young man, being destroyed, and she thought it was outrageous.
Coincidentally, it was a Liberal, Emlyn Hooson, who was then Mrs. Parry-Jones's MP. She got in touch with him. Alarmed by what he learned, Hooson, a barrister, invited Mrs. Parry-Jones and Scott to come to London to meet some of his parliamentary colleagues in the Liberal Party.
And David Steele was very brisk and said that the whole thing was lies and it couldn't possibly be true. And so I felt that I must show him what I'd taken down with me, this file of the letters, the Bessell letters, which proved that there had been something done to contain me. And David Steele completely changed when he read this file and said, this is absolutely dreadful. And his words were, he'll have to go.
As a result of this, Lord Byers, the Liberal leader in the Lords, was consulted. He asked to see Scott in order to judge the allegations for himself.
He, well, proceeded really to call me a common blackmailer, of which there was no need and there was no evidence. I mean, it's just something I'm not. And said that I was very sick. And I said, and he said, you have no proof of this. You can't really prove that there was a relationship. I said, well, there is evidence if you really read it properly.
Now, what Scott didn't know was that at the same time, Thorpe was working behind the scenes, in the words of prosecuting counsel, to fix the record. Well, he did fix it. Through a complex series of meetings and phone calls, Thorpe manipulated the Home Secretary, Reginald Maudling, and the Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police, Sir John Waldron, into actually endorsing his cover-up story to the Liberals. He was even cleared to ask the Commissioner direct questions about the confidential police file on Norman Scott. Scott, however, wasn't doing so well. He still wanted his famous Bunny's letter back from the police in order to prove his allegations against Thorpe. We know that eventually Reginald Maudling and the Commissioner met to discuss Thorpe's dilemma. The Home Secretary was shown the Bunny's letter. He read it, held it, and mused that he now had Thorpe's career in his hands. Far from wrecking it, he decided to help him out, and what happened was this. Thorpe had prepared a letter for private circulation to his accusers and supporters in the Liberal Party, including Lord Byers. It contained his dishonest version of the Scott affair. It smeared Scott as a nutcase. In order to give that letter real authority, real clout, he got the Home Secretary and the Commissioner to endorse it by sending him a separate letter, effectively authenticating Thorpe's cover-up version. The Home Secretary wrote, "Dear Jeremy,
Thank you for showing me your letter to Frank Byers. I've shown it to the commissioner. Neither of us sees any reason to disagree. A triumphant Thorpe then circulated both letters. The Liberal Party inquiry collapsed. He was vindicated, his political enemies routed, and Scott totally discredited.
It was now 1973. Scott had moved back to North Devon, a sick and troubled man. He was drinking heavily and taking large prescribed doses of tranquilizers and sleeping pills. He remained obsessed with an affair now 10 years old. As ever, he was penniless.
After the election, bitterly divided, section against section, class against class, interest against interest.
For Jeremy Thorpe, the February 1974 election brought him to the pinnacle of his political career. He swept his own constituency with a greatly increased majority, but much more significantly, the Liberals polled 6 million votes and returned 14 MPs to the House. So close was the election result that in the first heady hours of that February morning, it looked as if Jeremy Thorpe and the Liberals could indeed hold the balance of power.
Mr. Thorpe, you are the kingmaker in this situation, to use that term, but that is what you are.
Well, I'm not exactly sure that I accept that title.
Prime Minister Edward Heath certainly thought so, and he promptly invited Thorpe to 10 Downing Street to discuss terms for a parliamentary coalition. The Prime Minister offered Thorpe a strong deal, one that would have brought Thorpe straight into the heart of government.
I said, what did you have in mind, or what did the Prime Minister have in mind? And he said, well, it would have either have been the Home Office or the Foreign Office.
So by February 1974, an extraordinary situation had developed. Jeremy Thorpe, leader of the Liberal Party and potential security risk, was within grasp of one of the highest offices in the land. He would certainly have had a cabinet post. He wanted to become Home Secretary. Incidentally, that would have made him ministerial head of MI5 and in charge of his own security file. As minister in charge of the Metropolitan Police as well, he would have had access to his police file too. The fact is that everyone who needed to know did know about his secret homosexuality that left him so vulnerable to blackmail. The police knew and had their files. So did Special Branch. So did the security services MI5 and MI6. The Home Office knew and had its file, and the Prime Minister himself, Ted Heath, should certainly have been told. But if by 1974 there were only ineffectual whispers in Whitehall, there were now shouts elsewhere.
The coalition never happened, but by November 1974, yet another report was sent by Devon and Cornwall police to the security services, following information from someone who thought it odd that a Privy Councillor might be gay and a blackmail target. It was by now quite clear to Thorpe that the Scott problem would never go away.
We've almost cleaned the board.
A final plan was prepared. Thorpe was to delegate the entire unsavoury business to his close friend and former best man, David Holmes. He used two middlemen to recruit Andrew Newton, the unprofessional hitman, an airline pilot prepared to do anything for a laugh.
I contacted Holmes. Well, he said that Norman Scott was required to be killed. And then I asked him many questions, posing as a professional hitman. You know, where did he live? Was his place burglar alarmed? Did he have a dog? It sounds funny, but I did ask that question, and he said no. And we know that he had one of the biggest dogs he could possibly have. And how did he want him, disposed? And he said that if he just vanished from the face of the earth, he'd be quite happy.
Like something from an old B-movie, Newton posed as Peter Keane, a private detective hired to protect Scott from some fictitious assassin. He met up with him in Porlock and tricked him into what should have been Scott's last ride.
When I got into the car, I said, I'm so sorry, but I thought you were going to come into the pub. You said that you'd meet me here at 8 o'clock. We drove on, then, up Porlock Hill. I was slightly embarrassed because I didn't have very much to say to him and he wasn't speaking to me.
There was just an awkward silence. I think he sensed that there was something was going to go on. Fear breeds sort of fear, and you feel it in the atmosphere.
We're driving on, and the headlights kept coming on down, and he said he was tired.
I was faking to be tired because I wanted time. I was driving very slowly. I didn't know what to do because there was this enormous dog sitting behind me.
And I really couldn't understand why I'd been brought here and nothing was being said.
Perhaps I could wait for the dog to get out and then drive off and then have Norman Scott on my own. As it happened, we stopped.
So I got out of the car and he was already out. And Rinka was out on the moors jumping around. And then he just shot her.
And I said, I've shot the dog and now it's your turn.
And then he leveled it at me and then came back. And I suddenly realised he was going to shoot me as well.
But the gun jammed and Scott survived.
The death of the dog on the moor should have exposed the relationship between Scott and Thorpe once and for all. So what went wrong? Because the dog was shot in Somerset, Detective Chief Superintendent Mike Challice, head of the Somerset and Avon CID, was given the job of investigating the crime. But as soon as it emerged that Norman Scott was involved, the neighbouring county police force, Devon and Cornwall, had an interest too, because they had by now a large and comprehensive file on Scott and Thorpe.
In ordering the two separate police forces to investigate the death of the dog, the DPP effectively split that investigation in two. The effect of this unusual instruction was to produce an investigative failure.
Andrew Newton was arrested and in 1976 put on trial for possessing a firearm with intent to endanger life. He admitted shooting the dog, but told a pack of lies, alleging Norman Scott had blackmailed him, so he shot the dog to frighten Scott off. Newton was jailed for 2 years. And when released, he told me...
The one thing at that trial was I couldn't actually tell the truth. I couldn't say, look, yes, there was a conspiracy to murder, but I backed out. I mean, think of the ramifications of that.
All this was naturally very good news for Jeremy Thorpe. So by several strokes of fortune, his attempts to have Scott murdered had remained covered up. So, as a bonus, had details of his old affair with Scott. It might have stayed like that, but for one totally unplanned and unexpected development. Out in California, Peter Bessell, the loyal retainer and troubleshooter for 13 years, finally decided enough was enough. Bessell knew it was now time to tell all.
The most difficult decision I've ever had to make in my life was the fact that all I knew was because Jeremy trusted me. In other words, I had not picked up my information by hearsay or, if you like, from third parties. It was direct knowledge given to me on the basis that he trusted me totally. So that made it a very hard decision. But we moved from an area of a private cover-up of somebody's private life into an area where it was now a cover-up of an attempt at murder. Now, there's a point at which all of us stop, and that was the point at which I stopped. Everything which Jeremy and I had fought for when we were young men, where had we gone? What had become of us? And as I say, it was a very rough decision to make, but it was one I had to make.
By the first week of May 1976, Peter Bessell's initiative had begun to create intolerable pressures on Thorpe, and the weekend of the 8th and the 9th were to prove crucial for him. I had myself already gone to California to interview Bessell for Panorama the following Monday. Back in London, Thorpe now moved very fast. He allowed the Sunday Times to publish the Bunny's letter. The impact, as he must have known, was devastating. Even in cold print, it was a very compromising document. The effect was to allow Thorpe to announce his resignation as leader of the party the following day. He blamed a sustained press witch hunt. That announcement was followed by a wave of sympathy for Thorpe and real concern that his private life was his own business. Against this background, my interview with Bessell was not to be transmitted.
Once again, Thorpe had achieved a tactical victory. By sacrificing his leadership, he managed to protect the deeper truth about the murder plot. And there it might have ended, but for one of the supreme ironies of the case.
Sir Harold Wilson, angered by the injustice he felt had been done to Thorpe, personally contacted a number of Fleet Street editors to try to deflect them towards allegations about a South African smear campaign against leading British politicians, including Jeremy Thorpe. The BBC responded. Sir Charles Curran, the Director General, was personally briefed by Sir Harold.
I had been interested in the South African allegations. I was much less interested in revelations about Jeremy Thorpe, because, take my state of mind, at the time when I was making these decisions, Jeremy Thorpe had lost his leadership of the Liberal Party. The political status of Jeremy Thorpe was finished. He was not any longer capable of being important in the political scene. Now, if he had been still the leader of the party, then, of course, it would have been an important matter to pursue the investigations further, on the political ground alone. The story seemed to be turning into a kind of semi-criminal investigation.
I was not allowed to report it at that stage, for I think essentially the same reasons that you've mentioned. Thorpe was down, he had resigned, and nobody wanted to kick
him. It was a dead political story.
Right, but it wasn't just a political story. Do you think, then, that the BBC might reasonably be accused of having been involved in any kind of cover-up itself on this story?
No, certainly not. You see, in order to argue a cover-up, you have to say that the BBC wanted to hide the facts. Now, there's no question that the BBC wanted to hide the facts. The BBC had considerable doubts about whether there were sufficient hard facts to publish.
But the answer to that is that nobody was ever given the opportunity to bring the facts in.
That's always a possible thing to do, to say.
Did you take outside political advice?
I spoke, for example, to William Whitelaw, to Lord Aldington. And although both of them would certainly not have wished to harass Jeremy Thorpe, they certainly wouldn't have discouraged us from pursuing the South African story, which, as I say, was the one I was interested in.
So they took the view that it would be a good thing not to investigate the Jeremy Thorpe story?
No.
But you know they would have taken that view?
If I had asked them, should I go and pursue Jeremy Thorpe, they would have said, well, is it the decent thing to do?
You know that by instinct?
Well, of course, yeah, of course they would.
As, inevitably, the investigation into the alleged South African connection petered out, reporters renewed their attempts to investigate the growing mysteries and doubts surrounding Newton's trial at Exeter the year before. It was the London Evening News who got there first, and in doing so forced the hand of the police. It persuaded Newton on his release from prison to confess to the conspiracy of the cover-up. That story broke on October the 19th, 1977. A new director of public prosecutions instructed the police to begin a new investigation. It ended with Thorpe being put on trial for conspiracy to murder.
Prosecuting counsel in the trial, Peter Taylor, with a fine sense of poetry and sympathy, called the whole story a tragedy of truly Greek or Shakespearean proportions, the slow but inevitable destruction of a man by the stamp of one defect.
So that was the programme planned to go out at the end of the trial. Even then, we had no doubt that Thorpe had conspired to kill Norman Scott. But the jury disagreed, and Thorpe and his co-defendants were found not guilty. The judge, Mr. Justice Cantley, in one of the most astonishingly partial summing-up speeches ever to a jury, attacked all of the main prosecution witnesses. Peter Bessell, he said, was a humbug. Andrew Newton, the gunman, a buffoon, perjurer, and almost certainly a fraud. And Norman Scott, a crook, fraud, sponger, whiner, and parasite. Jeremy Thorpe, by contrast, was a national figure with a very distinguished public record. If there was any reasonable doubt that Thorpe had a plan to kill Norman Scott, you will acquit, the judge told the jury, and they did.
I have always maintained that I was innocent of the charges brought against me,
And the verdict of the jury, after a prolonged and careful investigation by them, I regard as totally fair, just, and a complete vindication.
Jeremy Thorpe retired from public life, maintaining his innocence to the end. He died of Parkinson's disease in 2014. And there the story might have ended, but there was to be another twist and another dog.
I was walking my dog here in Chiswick Park when a man passed me and said three things. First of all, he said, "You're Tom Mangold." Next, he said, "You know all about Jeremy Thorpe." And the third thing he said was, "I was hired to kill Norman Scott." At this stage, I put my arm around him and I guided him to this seat here.
It turned out that we were near neighbours. He was Dennis Meehan, a small-time criminal and gun specialist, who told me something I'd never heard before, that he was the first hitman hired to murder Norman Scott. Meehan said that for him, it all began in 1975, when he went to what used to be the Ritz Cafe in Shepherd's Bush to meet his old school friend, Andrew Newton. He introduced Meehan to a man I believe to be David Holmes, Jeremy Thorpe's best man, and who, says Meehan, made a remarkable offer. He said Norman Scott was becoming a nuisance to the Liberal Party, so would Meehan travel to Devon, shoot Scott dead in return for a fee of £13,500, that's some £140,000 in today's money. Meehan agreed. I persuaded Dennis Meehan to be interviewed for a Radio 4 documentary broadcast after Jeremy Thorpe's death.
Was it your intention to kill Norman Scott?
Well, I had it in mind to do it, but the conditions would have had to be right. You know, it's a big step shooting somebody. And
Let me just ask you again, because it just needs a yes or a no. Was it your intention at that time to kill Norman Scott?
Yes.
But when he reached North Devon, Meehan says he lost his nerve, turned round and drove back to London. He then gave his gun to Andrew Newton. And when he was arrested back in 1975, Newton gave Meehan's name to the police. Meehan, in turn, says he gave a statement he believed to the Metropolitan Police. In it, he says he admitted everything about the contract and conspiracy to murder Scott. But a few weeks later, Dennis Meehan says he received a strange anonymous phone call inviting him to a police station of his choice. So he went to Brentford and was handed a brand new statement.
They give me the envelope. Told me to go into one of the interrogation rooms. And I just went in there on my own, read the statement, which did me no end of favours. But it did Jeremy Thorpe no end of favours as well, because it left him completely out of it. So I thought, well, I've got to sign this. So I signed it.
But it excludes everything you said about Jeremy Thorpe and the Liberal Party, and it takes you off the hook.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. That's why I signed it.
So the effect was, you would never appear in court.
That's right.
That remarkable admission by Dennis Meehan had grabbed the attention of one special Radio 4 listener. This week, I went to see him down in the West Country.
Dr. Livingstone, I presume.
Nice to see you.
Nice to meet you.
How do you come in?
What did you make of Dennis Meehan's statement?
Well, I thought it was quite chilling, actually, because I didn't think it would all come out again, and I was so pleased that, you know, there was somebody still doggedly trying to sort it for me.
Because you'd never heard about the Ritz Cafe meeting,
no,
had you?
No, not at all, no. All I knew was Newton.
You must have asked yourself, how did Newton get the idea in the first place? There must have been somebody else.
Yes. But I knew there was something to do with Thorpe. There were five different attempts, and I was aware of two of them.
And were you ever invited to go to Florida?
Yes, indeed. But the plan was really to get me there and then put me into a helicopter and drop me in the Everglades. And
I mean, I'm sorry, I'm laughing. I'm not being disrespectful.
But
they weren't kidding, were they?
No, they were not. No. And another one was to drop me, get me drunk, so I fall off the stool, and then they would pick me up, take me out of the pub, and then drop me down a tin mine in Cornwall. It's just, it is laughable, but it's also very, very serious.
My revelation about Dennis Meehan's claim prompted an independent investigation by Gwent Police, which lasted more than 1 year. That investigation, however, has been somewhat marred by Gwent's conclusion that Andrew Newton, the last living witness who could corroborate Meehan's allegations, is dead. So the Crown Prosecution Service told Norman Scott that partly because of Newton's death, no further action could be taken on the case. It now turns out that, incredibly, Gwent Police might well have got that wrong. They've suddenly conceded to us that they now think Newton may be alive. I broke the news to Norman Scott.
It looks as if Andrew Newton may still be alive, yes, despite the fact that Gwent Police and the Crown Prosecution Service confirmed his death. Mm. What do you make of that?
I don't think anybody's tried hard enough to look for him. I really don't. There must be people who knew him, and there would surely be record of him dying, surely. I thought that they were doing something at last, and soon found out that absolutely they weren't. They were continuing the cover-up, as far as I can see.
I mean, you've seen their final statement, and you've got the letter there from the Crown Prosecution Service.
Yes.
The answer is, we're satisfied nothing has happened and nothing is going to be done. Is that a suitable response?
No, it's not suitable at all. There is obviously a lot of skullduggery going on.
But apparently most of the court records have been lost.
Have they? Heck. Of course they have. You can't. They would never do that.
When you look at everything that's happened over the last 40 years...
Yes.
Did you feel that's got to be a conspiracy, or do you think it was just plain circumstance?
Absolutely conspiracy to murder me.
Really?
Yeah, without a doubt.
But you could never prove it.
No, in a way, I suppose that's true. No, I can't.
Why does the Jeremy Thorpe story endure? Why does it go on generation after generation?
Because the truth hasn't come out. There's a conspiracy to murder me, and it won't seem to go away, and I have to see it through.
Well, you see, other people would say the conspiracy to murder you was heard in court, due justice, due diligence, and they were all found not guilty. So there was no conspiracy to murder.
No, that's why the guy held a gun to my head and killed my dog and left me to make a fool of myself the rest of my life. People not believing in me. But I ain't believe in myself, and I know a lot of people do, a lot of my friends do.
40 years after the failed attempt to murder Norman Scott, and Britain has become a much more tolerant society. And yet, we still don't know who had the power and authority to tip the scales of evidence in Jeremy Thorpe's favour, helping him to escape conviction. What we do know is that it took a heck of a lot of doing, and it was then and remains to this day the real Jeremy Thorpe scandal.
All three episodes of the BBC drama based on this extraordinary case, A Very English Scandal, are available on iPlayer now.